Fundamentals of software testing. What is being tested? There are various types of software testing. For example, you can divide it into functional testing, non-functional testing, and regression testing. In functional testing, we have these unit tests and integration testing and system testing and acceptance testing, what we have been discussing before. Then there could be also API testing, internationalization testing, and the non-functional testing side we have a documentation testing we have been discussing, then usability testing, reliability testing, scalability testing, penetration testing, performance testing, and this performance testing can be divided into load testing, endurance testing, and spike testing, for example. So here are something like 20 different types of testing, and these are just a tip of an iceberg. You can divide it to various ways. If we think about functional testing, with functional testing, one makes sure that the software has all the functions it is supposed to have. That means that it does all the things it has been specs to do. So if we have been describing that the program should have a button to print the report, so when we are doing functional testing, we are making sure that there is a button and the button really works. When you press it, there is a report being printed. Functional testing is the most formal one. And you can specify that this kind of function should be there, and if they are not, then customer knows that okay, then there is this function is not being developed. So it's pretty much yes or no, but in the end, yes, you can still end up in a courthouse if you are fighting kind of a customer or vendor. Then there are non-functional testing, and this is related to specs such as usability, responsiveness, and security. For example, if we want to test whether the software is easy to use, use case is easy to complete, these are non-functional testing. And if we think about the browser software, we could test that the software renders okay with various browsers, scales to different screen sizes and devices, so the website is usable with the mobile phone or tablet and desktop computer with Windows, Linux and Mac devices. So these kind of tests are good non-functional tests. And nowadays, of course, the security testing is quite important. So if the specs do not include button called security, so it's not a function, but it's still something that needs to be tested. And in penetration testing, tester tries to hack into the system and steal data. Non-functional testing is harder to automate. Some parts can be automated and some cannot. If we think about load testing versus usability, load testing, how many users can use the software simultaneously. It can somewhat automate it, but usability, it's always a bit subjective topic, so customer really wants to check if the usability is something what they wanted. So it's hard to automate those kind of things. Then the third one in this division was regression testing, which means testing that is conducted again and again and again when software is developed further. So the testing has been conducted, everything works. But then the background framework change. We are changing from Qt 4 to Qt 5 or Drupal 8 to Drupal 9. And every test is run again and again every time when something is changing to verify that everything is still working. So this is regression testing, and it's important when the software life cycle is let's say 20 years, and then other softwares and APIs are improved during the life cycle, and thus we need to do a lot of regression testing. And it's not a surprise that some of these regression tests can be automated. It's not a problem. But then again, once again, we are talking about usability, user experience, so we required manually done testing. For example, if we are chasing from Bootstrap 3 to Bootstrap 4 in web page design, then we need to do manual testing to see if the website is still looking as we want it. As was mentioned earlier, bugs tend to come to new code, so if we are doing something new, then we need to do regression testing to those parts that have not been changed but are somehow related to these new codes. Which means that if something is changed, risk for bugs, and regression testing should be run, which can pretty much done automatically in this sense. And the aim is to make sure that once fixed problems do not come up again. It's really pain in the ass if you are fixing the same problem from year to year every time something's changed. And few notes on the most used types of testing. We have been now discussing unit integration and system and acceptance testing, but as mentioned, there are a lot of other testing types. For example, API testing means tester is testing API. Who would have guessed? But it means that it is usually black box testing. There is another video that is discussing these techniques. A tester asks the API to return or input a data set and compare it to desired outcome. So let's say we want to upload our name and city to some system through API. We set name and city to the API, and let's see if the system then has this name and city in there. And this is something that somewhat can be automated. But of course, if we are using an API that returns some kind of images, let's say there are images of every person in the university, and we want to find image based on the student name, it pretty much needs to be tested with human needs to be tested manually if the name and the face is correct. And then internationalization testing, it means that the tester checks if the software is usable with different languages. In the 60s, pretty much all the software was basically English, but nowadays we have localized it to different languages. So we need to make sure that the software does not fail if we input, for example, Korean, or put some emojis there. As we can see here, Google Slides does not fail. They can present Korean letters or this nice hedgehog here. Different text take space differently in different languages, so the user interface needs to be designed in that way that you can have a different text there. Usability testing is one of the most important types of testing. In some cases, it's the most important. Would you use iPhone or Android phone, or do you prefer even Windows or Surface phone, and why? If you think about these kind of questions, in many cases the answer is I use this XXX as it is easy to use. That's why I'm using. And guess what? XXX here doesn't mean an adult content of any kind. So in usability testing, tester determines whether the software is easy to understand, learn, and operate. Nielsen Group is a good one if you want to get material about usability issues and testing and the principles. And this is one of the reasons you can wonder why these slides are in Google Drive and not in Microsoft OneDrive. I prefer Google Drive as it is easy to understand, learn, and operate, and it's much faster, faster in response. Usability also includes, to some extent, an attractive look, which is very subjective to whether it's me or someone else who is looking it. And when we are talking about usability, one also often discusses about user experience. And if we are doing computer games, then the user experience is probably one of the most important, if not the most important part of the game design. If the game experience is bad, then the game probably is not good, although it would be perfect in security and it would be fast. And but if the user experience bad, then the game will not be a success. And nowadays, accessibility is also very relevant as regulations demand all the public services to be accessible for everyone. So that's why, for example, all university systems should be usable with a screen reader or these kind of devices, which are used by disabled people. All systems should be usable for everyone. And some usability and accessibility testing can be automated. There are services like Wave, which helps, gives you a report what is not working and what should be improved. Then there are companies like Siteimprove that work with these topics. They help to automate usability and accessibility testing. Usability can be analyzed with technical tools such as eye tracking devices, and then there are JavaScript libraries used in a web environment that record mouse movement on web pages, which is a kind of controversial topic. That is it even legal that you record what kind of a mouse movement is used and what keys are pressed when someone is inputting passwords and such? But in the end, you get this kind of a heat map to show what the user has been reading or what buttons he has been clicking, etc., etc. So then you realize here that in this Wikipedia page, user has been checking the first links in the left navigation bar, then the first topic area of the text, but not the image. And then there has been something. This image has been much more interesting. And then there is a list of text. It has been somewhat interested, and there has been image that is interesting. User has been focusing with his eyes to those topics, and then the designer can understand that these are the parts that work. And those, if we would have some kind of advertisement here and it would have not been clicked or watched at all, then then the design would be not good if the aim is to get the user press the advertisement or read it through. And one can also completely monitor and record what the user is doing. Just put a video camera to the room where the user is using the computer, and the more the user, more the test user swears, the more there is a room for improvement, of course. Usability testing can start before the programming has started, so user interface design starts in the early phase of the software development, and then as soon as there is some kind of idea what the user interface is, then there can be concepts and mockups that can be tested. And usability tests usually include testers that have nothing to do with the project. So if there is a let's say university system implemented, and then it should have thousands of users, all the students should use it. Then there are this company that is creating it, programming it, designing it. They are blind for their usability errors. They test the software, they have been developing it, they know how to use it. And there is this customer group that has been buying this system. They know how to use it, they know what they have been wanting. And then we need to bring in people that have never been using the software and do not know how the system should be used. They are testers that we need to have. But of course, if it has thousands of users, we can only take like a 10. Those would be represent and all of those thousands of users, and use then beta testers, of course, just before the real launch to get the last bugs out. Then we have performance testing, and with that we can have different viewpoints, how to handle peak points, how to take care if there is a distributed denial of service attacks or something like that. Load testing. So we have a requirement saying that 1,000 concurrent users must be served if they are online at the same time. Then we can have a test with 1,500 automatic virtual users to concurrent going through the software, and to see then the vendor can see if the system can handle that many users. And if not, then there is something that we need to deal with. Then stress test, which is a pretty much like load testing, but it's the test where you really push the system to the limits until it breaks and you see what is the limit. And then one needs to wonder how to make sure that the software can scale up if the user base is tenfold. Now we have something like 5,000 students in our university, and the systems work well with 5,000 users, but what would happen if our university would have 50,000 users, students? Would all the systems still work when they should the software scale up perfectly, or would there be any problems? Penetration testing. So when a piece of software is available through the internet, someone will definitely try to penetrate it. So if you are not taking care of security, then you don't want to put your software available through internet. And white hat hackers test services and find whether they have weak points. And of course, nevertheless, organizations should have guidelines to follow if when security breach happens. There is no system that could not be penetrated. Software has always bugs and they need to be updated. And then there is this thing that different types of testing overlap somewhat. So there are really no standards. So what we are talking about, we can talk about unit tests, but they are something that developers find very similarly in every guidelines. But then if you are talking about acceptance testing, it can be wide, it can be narrow, who is doing it, what is being in it, there is no real definition what to include in acceptance testing. And what is in user experience? If you are testing user experience, then what need to be tested and who is doing accepting and what? It's much much wider definition. Some testing tasks are included in multiple testing types, so there are no just plain rules, but various ways of definitions. This organization, this ISTQB, has been creating common terminology. You can find it from there, and if you search for some kind of a definition for example unit test or acceptance testing or usability, you get the definition. It is a good way to start this process, but it's definitely not yet finished to make standardized definitions. So if we think about usability and usability testing, it's a one thing. Then if we think about performance, they are a bit overlapping. So in a usability, you don't want to have a slow system. It's a usability thing, but it's then again it's also performance issue. If we're thinking about acceptance testing, in acceptance, the customer probably wants to have the usability thing and the performance thing be okay, so they are overlapping. Then if you are adding accessibility there, of course accessibility is related to usability and it's probably relevant to acceptance testing, but then again accessibility and performance do not have that much in common. And if you put the rest of the mentioned testings here, then you would have some kind of a spider web there, things to overlap each other. Different tests, different testers. Although all the testing tasks might sound suitable for general tester, it is not the case. So there are different people for different testing tasks. If we have a web page user interface, it's pretty much something that can be tested by junior tester. So for example, if a third year student find summer jobs as a tester, he or she can be involved in the web page user interface testing. But high quality security penetration testing requires years of experience. It's something that you really need to be an expert there. There is this Yle series called Team Quack. It's definitely worth watching. It describes what is penetration testing, how you can break into systems like car operating systems or some big company, how do you infiltrate and get the access to all the systems there. Pretty interesting stuff. So different test experts do different testing. And as a conclusion, there are dozens of different testing types. Some of them are related to basically all all the software projects, so unit testing, integration testing, system testing, usability testing, these are things that are relevant basically to all software projects. And today, many of the testing tasks can be automated, but definitely not all. User experience testing is something that is quite impossible to automate it completely. And security related testing is increasing as software is used via devices connected to the internet. It's also important to understand that if you want to make a career as a security tester penetrator, then there is really room for you. And to become senior tester, it requires a lot of work experience.